on social impact of public hotspots.
Thank you. So that's the talk beyond hardware and software. Clemens invited me to that talk, and I'll talk to you about the social impact of public hotspots. Who am I? My name is Andreas Breu. I'm from Berlin. I'm a software developer and do Freifunk since more than 10 years now, and I'm also a member of the board of the Förderverein Freie Netzwerke. It's one of the organizations, non-profit organizations in Germany that helps Freifunk to live there, to get funded and so on. A short note on the format of this talk. I just prepared some slides to show the social impact of Freifunk networks in Germany, and I'd like to discuss about your experiences in your local communities. Maybe we can discuss about the social impact you know from your home community. Okay, I think the most of you already know Freifunk. Freifunk exists since 2003. At the moment, we have more than 400 local communities in Germany and some in Austria. I think we also collected the Funkfeuer communities in our Freifunk API. And all those communities build a mesh network or build mesh networks with more than 45,000 Wi-Fi nodes, which grow very rapid in the last years. Since Freifunk exists, we had a lot of up and downs. I think the first peak was between 2006 and 2008, when a lot of people didn't have a chance to get an internet access like DSL lines, so they began to share their own DSL lines with their neighbors and the whole neighborhood using Freifunk. It was also the time when the first routers like the WRT 54 got cheaper and available, so we could use smaller routers and build mesh networks without using a whole computer under the rooftop. So why do we do all this? Because there are some human rights we want to fulfill. First is access to education and the freedom of information. So we want to enable people to get access to information they need, to get access to the internet. It was, I think, the UN and also Nicolas Negroponte who said internet access is a human right, so everyone should have access, and the first try to get this goal was the One Laptop Per Child program a lot of years ago. And they also used mesh networks to build their network to access, for example, internet or other information. So, about the situation in Germany. Maybe you know we had some things that we didn't get so much public Wi-Fi available. The biggest thing was so-called Störerhaftung or secondary liability or third-party liability. There isn't an exact translation because a lot of countries don't have this this legal construct, and this thing Störerhaftung was a big problem because you could get some legal problems. You got letters. You have to pay for downloading movies or music because someone else did it with your internet access. And so a lot of people didn't want to share their own internet access because they didn't want to pay, or they don't want to pay for anything someone else did. For Freifunk, it was one reason that it grew so much in the last years, because we built a technical workaround. We used VPN tunnels to tunnel all the internet traffic to our own servers, so people don't, or the, your own internet access won't be the point where the movies were downloaded or music. And in the last years, it got easier to have firmwares. For example, the Gluon firmware was one very big and important part of it, that a lot of people were enabled to build their own mesh networks. And on the other side, we also raised some political campaigns against it to improve this law, not to be judged for something others did to us. We also had some legal actions. We just went to court and said we want to fight against these Abmahnungen. It's called Abmahnung when you get a letter from a lawyer, and we want to fight against it. And until now, we almost won all this things. So we were quite successful, and in Germany now we have new laws where you can't get judged for your open Wi-Fi when you did something. One other aspect is we got a lot of funding the last years. Some private companies funded us. They gave money and or provided locations to build their own network in, for example, in their shopping malls or in streets in the cities. But we also had a lot of public funding. For example, some cities or states provided money and location in, for example, in Thuringia. There was it was the first state in Germany where they had the goal for their government to support Freifunk and to let Freifunk grow, but unfortunately it ran in the wrong direction, and they only supported one city, not all the Freifunkers in this state. But there are also other examples. For example, in Marburg, it's a city in Hessen in Germany, they give when you buy a router and make it a Freifunk router, then they give you some of the money back. So they support individuals to build up the network there. And I think this is a very positive example. And in Berlin, we had the opportunity to build a backbone network about the rooftops, above the rooftops in Berlin. It's the so-called Berlin Backbone. And there the Medienanstalt Berlin-Brandenburg funded us for about 3 years to build this. We also do some educational projects with public institutions to just enable people to build their own networks, not just to give hardware to them, but just they learn how networks work, how to set it up, and how to play with the networks. It's just for them to experiment and so on. And last but not least, we know some ISPs. They provide us fiber to the rooftop, for example, or they provide bandwidth and connectivity to the internet, so we can play with all these things and improve Freifunk and mesh networks in the cities more and more. Yes, and one problem is when a company do some funding, they just have in mind, oh, I can improve something for my customers. It's not for general use. They often do it to have more customers there and so on, and to get a risk-free network where they can't get this Störerhaftung thing I mentioned before. Okay, where do we do our stuff? For example, in youth facilities in Berlin, we have a project. There are some media competence centers, and together with them, we try to build networks for their houses there. We want to include the trainers there, and also the people and the students. They are have their time there after school, for example, so they can learn how to build a network that it's like the internet, or they can build their own services there, for example, weather stations or chat or video stations, so they learn how it works to have such a thing like internet under their control. We also built a lot of backbone networks in Berlin, for example. There is one of the older backbone networks. I know the Hamburg community also builds backbone networks that work with Wi-Fi only. So we are looking for higher buildings and install hardware on the rooftop and interconnect all the routers via that backbone network. There are some guys, they use mesh networks for festivals or other events. These installations are temporary most times, but it's something we just use there. For example, there is the Hessentag this weekend in somewhere, and they just installed a Wi-Fi installation there so people can enjoy having Wi-Fi and internet access everywhere and use it. And what I told you before, some shopping centers also built a Wi-Fi network in there, and this is paid by the people having their shops, or it's paid by the people and installed by Freifunk activists to use it there. Another important things are refugee camps. It started in 2012 in Hamburg, for example. There were some refugees, they should be sent back, and they were in a church. And so Freifunk supported the church to have a Wi-Fi installation there, so the refugees could get in touch with their families. They could phone to their former neighbors, or could get information about their countries, what's happening there. In 2012, there was also in Berlin the Oranienplatz, where they had something like a camp, because we had no homes for them, and so they camped there, and the Freifunkers of Berlin provided a Wi-Fi network. In 2015, we had much more to do. It was the time when really, really lots of people came here. I think it have been 500,000 that came to Germany. And it was a time where Germany, or our chancellor, was very open and said, yes, we can take them to Germany. And we had a lot of things to do. There were some emergency camps where they lived for the first time, and everyone asked, can you please provide Wi-Fi to them, because they want to inform what's going on in their home countries. They want to chat with their family, and they also needed help, for example, translating to Germany or filling out forms, because no one was prepared for that. And a lot of these installations have been temporary, but we also did some permanent installations. For example, in Berlin, now we have some houses there where refugees live, and a lot of other installations in gyms, for example, have been uninstalled again. We got more and more requests for help, for example, and so we launched a portal called Freifunk Hilft. It's called, translated, it's Freifunk Helps, where we get, where we collected information, what people need to create a network in their home, what they can do to support Freifunk, and so they are more prepared as just to say, can you give please Wi-Fi to us? And it helps, I think it helps both sides to understand each other. We also have influences in politics. We saw with the Störerhaftung, we can fight together for changes in law. Sometimes we are seen as experts. Politics is asking us to give commands on laws, for example, and we are also invited to government panels to speak there. It was, I think, in the last year we visited a panel for the digital agenda in Germany, where we could get our points there. Yes, and what our goals are, sometimes they ask, can you just install a Wi-Fi? But we want to show people how to build the Wi-Fi network and don't want to be a cheap alternative for raising up networks where they don't have any risk with it. We also have some problems with public Wi-Fi hotspots. Some people want to have us install Wi-Fi, and then they say, we have to do some use protection and please install these filters or block or ban some websites. This is no-go for us in Freifunk. We want to have an open network where you can access everything, and we can't just filter out some pages or websites or servers just for having use protection. I think our users, they know how to work around all these filters, and we don't need it. Some companies come to us and say, yes, we can give you some funding, but you have to install a captive portal so we can have some advertisement, or we can ask customers for some of their personal data. In Freifunk, we generally don't want to have captive portals because it's not open anymore when you have a captive portal and can't use the internet. But we have also some other problems, especially with the refugees. Some people complained, there are so many people in front of my house, they are loud, they are calling families, and especially at the night, please shut down this hotspot or this router. And this is the point where we just can say, just build some more access points somewhere else, so not everyone is sitting in front of your house, and we can distribute all the people better, or just bring internet to the refugees' home, so they don't have to walk through the half of the town and go to a point where they can access internet. And this is a problem we have from time to time, and sometimes it works that local politics says, okay, we give you some funding and you can build a Wi-Fi up there, and sometimes it doesn't work and we get phone calls, shut down this hotspot and so on. That's sometimes a bit of a problem. Okay, that were my slides, and now, if you have any experience how it works in your communities, we can just discuss about it. Is there anyone?
Huh. Does it work? It does. Okay.
I'm really just going to reiterate what Avery said a few days ago. LTE is just too cheap for many people, at least in this city, to really start doing something about their network. So very often you have open Wi-Fis in cafes. We don't have this Störerhaftung sort of thing. And then it's really, okay, so maybe you're using a commercial provider. Maybe they ask you for your email address or show you some advertisement when you sort of connect to the access point for the first time. But then this is so small of a hurdle for most of the people that I think we trying to provide with Funkfeuer an open network that also has hotspots all over the town is a lot of work for us. We have far too few volunteers to sort of roll that out if we were really planning to do that, which we are not as far as I know. And then there are so many alternatives that 99% of the people choose. So in this is a bit of a contrast to how people are buying food over here, because organic is really huge. So I think, I don't know the exact figures, but it was something like 30% of all food that is bought has some sort of organic label over here. For networks, there is no such thing. And there's only a few companies that that offer commercial access to networks that also are trying to get onto this train, saying, okay, this is like a fair network that is not shaped and not filtered and so on. But for most of the people, I think this is really not the problem. That the 5 or 10 or maybe 100 websites that they are interested in, they work. And everything else, they just don't care. This shouldn't sound too pessimistic, because I think this leaves much space for us to work in. So in some sort, we have lots of freedom to work in that space instead.
I can share some experiences from Chemnitz, because for one thing is we have the local government has decided that we are allowed to put something on every rooftop, but the problem is we don't have the people. So managing all the network is more than enough for us. So yeah, politically we have a pretty good point, but we're missing human power.
It's the same experience I can share. They always say you can have a lot of money, or it sounds like a lot of money, but we don't have the people and time to spend all the money and to install the hardware we buy from that money. That's one thing.
Okay, I'm Reinhard. I'm living in Greece, and we are working about 8 years technically to get something up, which happened in the technical way. So we have 22 knots and still are only 1.5 person, so me and my wife doing that. If I listen to this, what your experience is, it sounds for me very far away, and it sounds for first world problems. And we have, like say, fifth world problems, which we live in a very rural area. We have no support for nobody. We have the country, we have all sorts of obstacles, what we do. We are strangers anyway after 30 years in Greece. So for us, it's a very, very, very different view on things. Like if we want to convince somebody to give us uplink, without a captive portal, there will be nothing going on. That's an implication what you do with it. So one does not like his coffee shop to be advertised in this, and the neighbor does not want to like to advertise, but he does not like the neighbor's advertisement, and so you get in some kind of struggle and you're in the media. Legal, we are about to follow up legal framework which is not existing. So for the Olympic Games, starting 2001, some in Athens and Patra, the networks, they died out because the funding was spent, the people went away. So the overall situation in Greece, there is one lively network, which is Sarantaporo, which there had been a battle measure over there, and 1.5 person we. So that's it. And we could manage to get over the last 2 years in universities and technical high schools to make connections, but there is no movement. So we think, or we hope, so the Exarchia project, which I will attend on Monday in Athens with the guys from Argentina and from Lipermesh, will give a little bit of push. This is just a reflection what, if I listen to you, and I think what we got, so there is a real, real gap on it. Thank you.
Hello. I'm from one of those small Freifunk communities, and I want to share a bit of my experiences. Our network has had a good growth pattern, and for now it's like steady in its numbers. And well, so far our experience is that well, it works, but for now it's. Well, it looks like it doesn't get to, well, anything more. There's a problem of scalability where the network has problems to scale, which is a technological problem. So we have constant costs to main servers. And also that most people, when they hear about Freifunk, they think of it as a cheap way to get into the internet. It's not that reliable, but hey, it's free. It doesn't cost anything. So I think there needs something to change. I mean, there's an ongoing debate how we can get users to recognize Freifunk not only as internet providers, but as a way to communicate between themselves, so and to make the network in itself more benefiting to the lives of the people, so that they are eager to set up more nodes, for example. So for now, well, it's okay, but it's a constant cost, but I think when it's not very good. When we look more into the future, because we have to think about how do we get further from there where we already are, and if we stay, things might get worse because when people associate Freifunk with only cheap internet, then well, internet will get better maybe for people. Then they say, okay, we don't need Freifunk. It served its purpose. While Freifunk still tries to solve quite a different problem. So this is just an opinion I want to share, and so thank you, and next one.
Thank you.
Comments, questions, opinions?
Just a question on what sort of outreach do people do to kind of increase the volunteer capacity of the core organizers and what kind of outreach do you do? Public workshops, or how do you reach out to find more technical volunteers?
Yeah, we usually have regular meetings. For example, in Berlin, we meet every week. We also have workshops. On different events, or we have special workshops if groups ask us to show them how it works and so on. And at the moment, I mentioned this education project. We try to build some education resources to have it visualized or written down how to build a Freifunk network. So we have something sustainable for the people to use it.
So for Funkfeuer in Vienna, I can say that we have weekly meetings, and there's also sort of bigger meetings every month. So the event on Monday, where we had Matthias talking about BGP and routing and, you know, and stuff like this, this was actually one of the monthly meetings where there's often a talk or two given about topics that are of interest to people that are interested in networks, not always totally focused on what we do in Funkfeuer, but still this is a nice way of attracting newcomers that might already have some background in the field or might just walk by MetaLab. So this is the way that we approach them, and very often I think that people just have heard about this network and then know where to find us. By the way, I wanted to ask a question to you, because so I've heard of NYC Mesh, for instance. This is comparable to Funkfeuer in some sense, because this is already a highly populated city where you have networks all over, and if you have some money, you can buy your access. And this is where enough people obviously live so that a network of this sort suddenly pops up and can exist and can sustain. But what about the rural areas? What about the places where the farmers live? They could have wireless gigabit links between their farms if they liked. And the way it is now, they have to buy from Comcast, AT&T, these companies that provide a service which, as far as I hear, is a joke most of the time. So what's so hard for these people to just step up and organize and do this? Is this something that they just don't care about because their interest is sort of inside the place they live in, and their neighbor's problem isn't their problem anymore? I'm just speculating. I have no idea what's going on there.
I also can't really speak to the more rural areas of the States, and I'm in Oakland, which is a fairly populated city, and we're kind of more geared towards building an urban mesh network, and do have similar outreach strategies of weekly meetings, monthly like general intro meetings, and quarterly workshops, build your own internet workshops. But I think doing more outreach to surrounding communities is something that maybe is in the future, but right now we're just about to do a wider public launch in Oakland at the end of the summer. And try to get a network going and self-sustaining, and then maybe apply it to other scenarios.
All right, thanks.
Hello there. Oops. I'm Rodrigo Treia, and actually right now I'm from Brazil, and we are working with kind of community networks there. Thank you. And when I saw your kind of fundings, sponsorings, and technical stuffs and problems, I saw different things, but almost the same projects. What we have now in Brazil, it's a kind of very different situation. We have some public hotspots. We have a lot of cover in kind of touristic areas, but almost 50% of the country still doesn't have connections. And we don't have a huge community of technical people interested in working with that. So what we see the main difference and about the public impact, the impact of these public hotspots are that, I don't know how to say that, I'm kind of hanging over, so it's too late, but main point to us is we don't have communities of technical people, we don't have public interest and cover a lot of areas, talking about something like rural areas, something like favelas, people who live on the rivers and fishers and things like that. So right now we are starting to make a kind of huge community based from people all over the country,
And we are looking for these sponsors for grants and stuff like that to get together and to go to these small villages and stuff like that, train these people to use the internet to make their own servers and things in this way. So what we see in practical way is that the people who never saw some equipment, never used the internet, when they start to use this, when they get in touch with this, they are kind of empowered. So when the most important impact to us, to this, is not about the connection, but it's about the empowerment that the people know when they, oh, I can do this. Oh, I can learn more about this. Oh, I can understand more the world right around me. It's not my community, it's not my village, it's not my city. It's bigger than that. And this is one of the most important impacts to us that we are seeing right now. It's, whoa, there is more. There is another people talking, trying and doing. And this is to us is something like we dream when the day we will have a large community of technical people who they can do by themselves. But right now, it's not a kind of question that we can do. Brazilian don't have these problems with kind of copyright. Yes, we have laws against copyright piracy, but actually it doesn't work very well. People are still using public hotspots to download movies, to see things like that. And we don't have this kind of, oh, I want to put a public Wi-Fi, but I use a hotspot, a captive portal to kind of monetize this. So it's a kind of very different situation. And in this way, I just think the main point to us is get connected and get people know it how to connect. It's a kind of gathering together people. And this is the most important part in my vision that we are going to do, are doing right now. Okay.
Yeah. Thank you.
Any more contributions?
Hmm?
No, I'm not really into that subject. I don't have that much experience here. Okay.
Okay, thank you
yep.
for being here, for discussing, for showing your experiences, and I will be here this evening so we can talk later from face to face.
So, short break, and at 4:30, we continue with lightning talks. There are two lightning talks on the schedule. One is about a peer-to-peer network called Leviathan, and the other one is about using mesh for rural education in India, 20 minutes from now.